Welcome to the December 3rd International Day of Persons with Disabilities webinar. Anin, Bojo, Danse, Wotie, Hohan, Tanshi, Tungatsuitsi. We would like to acknowledge that the IDPD webinar is located on Treaty 1 territory, the original lands of the Anishinaabeg, Cree, Oji-Cree, Dakota, and Dene peoples, and the homeland of the Métis Nation. We encourage you to reflect on the history of the land that you are watching from. So hi everyone, this is Erica Vass with the Disabilities Issues Office. For questions, comments, and technical assistance, please contact the Disabilities Issues Office at 204-945-7613, toll-free at 1-800-282-8069, extension 7613, or by email dio@gov.mb.ca. Please note that the accessibility features for today's webinar include captioning and ASL interpretation, and this is a recorded webinar, and the video will be available at accessibilitymb.ca in the near future. So without further ado, I'd like to now welcome Jutta Frick.
I'm going to start by just wishing everybody a happy International Day of Persons with Disabilities. It's our chance to celebrate that in Manitoba, we're part of a global community of people with disabilities, and that is really our strength. Today, we're celebrating International Day for People with Disabilities with a webinar program that's largely pre-recorded. The program includes a pre-recorded ministerial greeting from the Honorable Heather Stephenson, a short update from the Disabilities Issues Office. I remain live whenever possible. And then today's keynote presentation is also pre-recorded and includes the human rights lawyer Yvonne Peters in conversation with my colleague John Windles. I think many people are excited about our first ever Manitoba Accessibility Awards and the announcement of this year's winners, which will be the main part of today's program. We'll close with some closing remarks and suggestions for resources. Now it's my pleasure to introduce the Honorable Heather Stephenson, the Minister of Families, who for 16 years has served as the MLA for Tuxedo. In 2020, the Manitoba government appointed Minister Stephenson as the first minister responsible for accessibility. Welcome, Minister Stephenson.
Hello, everyone, and a warm welcome to the many accessibility champions, including businesses, nonprofit organizations, and members of Manitoba's disability community who are joining us today. Though we can't gather in person this year to mark this occasion together, please accept virtual greetings and hugs on behalf of the province of Manitoba and my colleagues here in the Manitoba Legislature. I'm honored to bring greetings today on the International Day of Persons with Disabilities, when Manitoba joins millions across the world in promoting the rights, dignity, and well-being of persons with disabilities. The United Nations theme for this year's International Day of Persons with Disabilities is "Not All Disabilities Are Visible." This is a reminder that we cannot assume the presence of a disability by the way a person looks. This theme is particularly relevant during this pandemic, where the priority is to reduce risk to individuals with underlying health conditions. The Manitoba government shares the United Nations' concern about invisible disabilities, with special consideration during an emergency. When it comes to emergencies, some employees who generally do not require workplace accommodations may still need support. And that is why we introduce safety requirements under the accessibility standard for employment. Beginning in May of this year, this regulation calls on all Manitoba employers to reach out to their employees to ask whether they need assistance during this pandemic. When the standard was developed several years ago, we envisioned a workplace emergency scenario where an employee with a heart condition could not run down 10 flights of stairs to evacuate the building. During this pandemic, keeping vulnerable employees safe may mean avoiding the workplace altogether. Accessibility is crucially integral to the rollout of the Manitoba government's response to the pandemic. This can be seen, for example, in ensuring American Sign Language interpretation during briefings and offering an interactive voice response to access the COVID-19 screening tool. I know Manitobans participating in this webinar are aware of the severity of the pandemic in our province and the tremendous sacrifices being made on the front lines in healthcare, social services, education, and the many services we rely on, and the impact particularly on individuals with disabilities. In these challenging times, it's important to also draw attention to the many heroes helping us fight the pandemic. The work that has taken place in the last 2 years to enhance universal access and inclusion has helped ensure the additional challenges of the pandemic are more manageable for everyone. In 2020, Manitoba Accessibility Award winners demonstrate the leadership and innovation necessary to ensure all Manitobans benefit from public initiatives. My sincere congratulations to the following six Manitoba Accessibility Award winners. In the category of large and small business, Winnipeg Airports Authority and the Red Apple Store in Stonewall. In the category of urban and rural nonprofit organizations, Gateway Church in Winnipeg and Woodlands Pioneer Museum in Woodlands, Manitoba. And finally, congratulations to the City of Selkirk and the RM of Victoria Beach in the category of large and small municipalities. I wish to note that in a province where much attention is paid to its largest city, Winnipeg, the awards demonstrate the commitment to accessibility is province-wide, with outstanding leadership shown by the Interlake region. I also wish to emphasize two common elements among the six Accessibility Award winners. Each of the nominations noted the importance of collaborating with community partners, particularly people who experience barriers to accessibility. For instance, the City of Selkirk worked with its age-friendly committee, and the Winnipeg Airports Authority reached out to disability organizations for advice and trial runs. There are many other valuable lessons to learn, both from the 2020 Manitoba Accessibility Award winners and the other organizations that were nominated. Today, you will learn more about the winning applications, but all nominations have been invited to share their stories and tips in the months to come. Accessibility is a long-term goal with short-term priorities across the Manitoba government. I look forward to sharing details of our two-year accessibility plan affecting 2021 and 2022, and thank individuals who provided their feedback through Engage Manitoba. Those of you who have been following our progress in implementing the Accessibility for Manitobans Act may be familiar with the work of the Disabilities Issues Office, including in coordinating today's event. Today, I'm pleased to announce that in future, this focus on accessibility will be reflected in the office's name. Beginning today, the Disabilities Issues Office, the new name for it, will be the Manitoba Accessibility Office. As you may be aware, today's event is taking place in the final month of Manitoba's 150th birthday celebrations. Like all other festivities during the pandemic, many of the government's plans were postponed to a post-pandemic period. In light of Manitoba's 150th, I'm especially pleased that today's event will honor the contributions of Manitobans with disabilities to our province, the country, and the United Nations' effort to secure human rights of persons with disabilities. Yvonne Peters, who is being featured today, is one of many Manitobans who have contributed to disability rights. Another leader is Jim Dirksen, who, like Yvonne, served on the Accessibility Advisory Council. Manitobans also cherish the memory of Alan Simpson, who was a local and national hero behind the global independent living movement. Alan worked closely with Henry Enns, who was also instrumental in moving Canada's and the United Nations perspective away from a medical model of disability and toward a social model, eventually leading to the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. Finally, I wish to thank Dave Martin, who made his mark in building and leading the Manitoba League of Persons with Disabilities and later 1010 Sinclair Housing Inc. Dave was also the second executive director of Manitoba's Disabilities Issues Office before becoming a special advisor to the Minister of Families. Please join me in thanking Dave for his many years of service and wishing him well in his recent retirement. We are fortunate that Yvonne is with us today to share some of the stories that have become a part of Manitoba's history. By looking back, we can learn from these experiences to plan the way forward. In closing, congratulations to the award recipients. Thank you to all those who worked hard to put this event together, and happy International Day of Persons with Disabilities. I wish everyone continued good health as we enter this holiday season. Please stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Stephenson. It is now my chance to also introduce you to our new logo. As Minister Stephenson noted, we are no longer the Disabilities Issues Office. In future, we are the Manitoba Accessibility Office, or the Bureau d'Accessibilité du Manitoba. So that is my brief update for the moment, because it's now time to welcome Yvonne Peters, who is our keynote speaker today. Yvonne is a human rights lawyer, has been for over 30 years. She served as legal counsel and advisor on a number of equality test cases involving disability rights and women's rights. And she continues her human rights work as a volunteer with a number of community organizations. Yvonne Peters is truly an accessibility champion. Please join Yvonne and my colleague John Windles in conversation.
As you heard mentioned earlier, December 3rd is the United Nations International Day of Persons with Disabilities, when Manitoba will join people across the world in promoting rights and well-being of persons with disabilities. In Manitoba, we've been very fortunate to have a number of genuine trailblazers in the field. In a year in which we celebrate Manitoba's 150th birthday, we wanted to take this opportunity to speak to one of Manitoba's leaders in the disability rights field and hear their reflections on the considerable gains accomplished and the work left to be done. Yvonne Peters is a human rights lawyer. She has served as the former chairperson of the Manitoba Human Rights Council, as well as the former chairperson of the Accessibility Advisory Council, which is the central body responsible for developing recommendations regarding accessibility standards in Manitoba. Hi, Yvonne.
Hi, thanks for having me, John. And may I just take this opportunity to wish everyone a happy International Day of Persons with Disability. I hope it's a day of celebration, hope, and renewed commitment to rights.
Thank you very much. Most people listening probably recognize Yvonne Peters as an important, for the important roles you played in human rights and accessibility development, but they know little, if anything, about your background. So tell me a little bit about your beginnings and how you got started in the field of human rights.
Well, thank you for asking. It's an interesting question for me to reflect on. I guess it was probably several influences throughout my life that came together and pushed me in this direction. But I'd say it goes back a long way to when I was 6 years old, perhaps. I went to an integrated kindergarten and did just fine and thought that was the way life was going to be. But when I was six, I was told, no, you cannot go to school with your sisters and your friends. You must get on a train in Saskatoon, travel for 2 days, and go to a residential school for the blind in Ontario. And I spent 10 months of the year there away from my family. And I didn't have words to describe it then, but I thought, this isn't fair. I don't like this. And while I was at the school, what I also discovered is that there was a difference in the way female and male students were treated. Male students certainly had way more privileges than female students. We were under, you know, quite a few heavy restrictions. So I thought, there is some unfairness. And then, of course, I witnessed, you know, what I would think, what I would call some brutal treatment of our Indigenous students and Inuit students in terms of how they were treated. So all of this made me think, this doesn't seem right. So fast forward to as I became a young woman, this was in the 70s. And of course, then there were lots of activities going on with women's rights. So I actually became a women's rights activist first, because that seemed most important to me in my life. But as I, you know, went through university and then graduated and started looking for jobs, I started encountering very weird experiences with employers who had very negative attitudes about persons who were blind. They worried about how I'd get to the washroom, how am I would be, you know, protect my safety, and what my colleagues would think of me. And they didn't really seem interested in what kinds of skills I had. And so this began to, you know, really gnaw at me. And I thought, wow, you know, this is not right as well. And I'll just conclude by saying what really put the icing on the cake for me was when I went and after my first degree, I went back to school and got a degree in social work. One of my projects involved looking at workers' rights. And I discovered human rights legislation, which was a real new concept to me. I was very excited about this. And then I discovered when I looked into the human rights legislation, which was, you know, really amazing because it protected people from discrimination, something I could relate to. But I discovered that people with disabilities did not have protection. So my experiences that I had encountered with employers would not be covered under human rights legislation. So that just ignited a fire in my soul, I guess. And I reached out to what was then the Voice of the Handicapped and said, come on, folks, we got to change this. And I found very amazing, experienced, like-minded people. And well, there you go. The rest is history.
I was actually injured in a car accident back in 1981. So I've been using a wheelchair for the better part of, coming up on 40 years, I suppose. And that was the first year that they introduced a curb cut in Manitoba. And so it's hard for me to believe all the changes that have happened as far as wheelchair technology and accessibility and everything in my, how I've been able to navigate my community. You're blind and have been blind for your entire life. Mm-hmm. Has accessibility improved considerably for persons with visual impairments over those same 30 years or same 40 years?
I'm going to say yes and no. Yes, I think you have to say yes, that that things have improved. When I, you know, was looking for a job in the 70s, we didn't have the technology that we have today, which gives us much greater access to all kinds of things, including print information and various pieces of equipment and so on. And as I said, back in the 70s, there certainly wasn't any legal protection for our rights. And nor did we have the disability rights movement, which I think was really instrumental in pushing the government for social policy change, for law reform. Back in the 70s, you know, it was all, disability was all under the guise of nonprofit charitable organizations that really had no concept of rights. So I think just the fact that we've actually been able to crystallize and identify that people with disabilities, blind persons, have rights has been very significant and very important. And there have been some good legal decisions that really articulate those rights. But the no part is, you know, even though we have the technology, there are still lots of barriers when it comes to attitudes about blindness. It's one of the disabilities that people seem to fear the most when surveyed. So that says to me there's a real misunderstanding about what it means to be blind. And certainly, you know, every day I encounter websites that are not accessible to me because they're designed with visual, you know, people who can see in mind, and so they use pictures and so on. So yes, we've come a long way. Yes, we still have a ways to go.
Let's go back to the 1980s and the Canadian Charter of Rights. Since 1982, the Canadian Charter of Rights is the highest law in the land. Section 15 guarantees the equality rights of individuals before the law. It guarantees that persons with disabilities are protected by and will receive the same benefits under the law as any other Canadian. Is that true that people with disabilities did not make the first draft of that section?
Yes, it is true. And let me just step back a little bit and say, in the late 70s, that's when the disability rights movement really got organized, especially on the national level. And so we've been pushing for inclusion of people with disabilities in all jurisdictions in terms of human rights legislation. Then Mr. Trudeau at the time, Pierre Trudeau at the time, came along and said he wanted to bring our constitution back from Britain, bring it to Canada, and he wanted to include a Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, which he did. And in that charter was the Equality Guarantee Section 15. And so there were lots of drafts put out, but the first draft went out and people with disabilities were omitted and women were not happy. And so then other drafts came out, which really were good drafts because they actually really expanded the notion of equality. You know, equality before and under the law, equality protection, and equality benefit of the law. So those are really important phrases. But as the continual drafts came out, people with disabilities were relentlessly omitted. That did change at the very last minute for a whole range of reasons that one can speculate on. Certainly because the media was now picking up on this issue through the protests that we held. And, you know, there were lots of rumors spreading around about people with disabilities taking over Parliament Hill. We certainly had insiders working for us in the political arena who were pushing for this inclusion. And of course, we were coming on to the 1981 International Year of Persons with Disabilities. So it would look pretty mean-spirited, you could say, of Canada to leave people with disabilities out of the Constitution during this important international year. So who knows what actually was the final spark that motivated Jean Chrétien to say that they would amend the clause. But the important thing is that it was amended, and at the very last minute, physical and mental disability was included in Section 15.
So tell me a little bit about what impact including disability has had in that section. Like, can you give us some examples?
Sure. I mean, I want to say one of the main reasons we really wanted to ensure that people with disabilities were included in Section 15 is because we didn't want in Canada for there to be a hierarchy of rights. So if people with disabilities are in human rights legislation, but not mentioned in the charter, does that mean they have less rights? That was our worry. So that's why we just really were very, you know, very vigorously insisting that we be included. Now, as you said, the Constitution, Canada's Constitution, is the top law of the country. And what it means is that all laws, all government laws, policies, programs, procedures must comply with the equality guarantee in Section 15. And that includes people with disabilities. And I think just, you know, two cases I would like to talk about, which I think really illustrate why Section 15 is so important. The first case is the Andrews case, and it was the very first case to actually consider the guarantee of equality under Section 15 by the Supreme Court of Canada. And the Council of Canadians with Disabilities and the Women's Legal Education and Action Fund, both equality groups, intervened in the case to make sure the court got it right. And if you read this case, you'll see that I think we had a pretty significant influence on the way the court interpreted this Section 15. And so what the court said is that equality isn't just about treating everybody the same. It is about ensuring that everybody benefits equally. What the judge said is the accommodation of difference is the true mark of equality. So that was really important because, you know, if we just treat everybody the same, if you give me a printed book and you give my classmate a printed book, they can say, well, you're being treated the same. What's your complaint? But of course, I can't benefit because I'm blind from a printed book. Now, another case where this was really played out and really well illustrated was the Eldridge case, I'll call it, which also was a Supreme Court of Canada case and also a case in which many equality seekers, including the Council of Canadians with Disabilities, intervened in. This case involved deaf people who were seeking health care in British Columbia. And when they of course, received health care, but they were not provided with sign language interpretation so that they could really understand the nature of the health care they were receiving. And they complained and said, this is not equality. We are not benefiting the same as others. And they took the matter to court. And the lower courts said, no, you are receiving equality. You're being treated the same as hearing people. You're getting health care. What is your concern? You are fine. But they said, no. And they appealed the case all the way to the Supreme Court of Canada. And at that court, that's where we got probably one of the most defining disability rights equality cases so far, in that the judges clearly said that simply treating people the same, and these are the words they used, they said, bespeaks a thin and impoverished view of equality. And they went on to say that the accommodation of difference is the cornerstone of equality, and that in order for full equality to be in effect, people must also benefit from equality, not just be treated the same, but they must be able to enjoy the benefit of the program that's being offered. So they not only get healthcare, they have to benefit from healthcare. So that was a very important decision in terms of defining what we mean by disability equality rights. And I will just say, in addition, just as kind of a part of that whole analysis that the court engaged in, it was the first time, as far as I know, that the Supreme Court actually acknowledged the social construct of disability, that disability is not just something that comes from the individual and is an impairment. It's disability is exacerbated by the way that our society is structured and arranged, and the court acknowledged, you know, the social implications of disability. So that was very important. There's lots of other cases, but those I think are two kind of key cases that stand out for me.
Well, you certainly followed, like, that seemed to be, you know, those, that was a precursor to where you took your career from there, where you served as the chairperson to the Manitoba Human Rights Commission for more than a decade, I think. And although most of the, you know, the adjudications of the commission are to resolve individual complaints, a number of the decisions lead to systematic changes. What are some of the resolutions in Manitoba that affected persons with disabilities?
Right. Yes, I did serve on the Manitoba Board of Commissioners for the Manitoba Human Rights Commission for many years. And I was, I think for 4 years, I was the chair. I just like to say a slight correction. You know, during the time that I was on the board, and I have no reason to think that this is any different, every complaint that is dealt with, the commission looks for what is the systemic issue here? Is there a systemic issue? It's not just an individual. There's no sense in just resolving individual complaints if you're not really addressing the key problem, which might be the way a policy is being administered or where there are barriers that need to be redressed. So I just wanted to make that point. But a couple of cases that I think are really illustrative of how systemic discrimination can be dealt with that occurred during my time. The first one was a complaint filed by Dave Martin, who many of you will know, and Ainley Bridgman, which I hope many of you will remember. They filed the complaint saying that the light signals, the pedestrian light signals were not accessible to persons who can't push the buttons and to persons who are blind who don't benefit from a visual cue. And I have to say, this was a new issue for the commission to deal with. And the complainants put a lot of effort into explaining this issue to the staff at the commission and was very helpful to the board. And in fact, as a result of that complaint and negotiations with the city of Winnipeg, many of them now are equipped with audible pedestrian signals so that you can hear when the light has changed and when it is safe to cross. And I think that was a very important decision, certainly made my life easier. And every time I go walking, I thank Dave and Ainley for their efforts. And interestingly, a few weeks ago, I got a phone call from Councillor Ross Eady, who told me that there was a plan in place for the city to institute these various pedestrian signals, audible signals. And the plan was spanning many, many, many years. I don't remember when it was to finish. Was it 2025? But the city just installed their final audible pedestrian signal as part of their plan just a few months ago. So way ahead of schedule. So, you know, there was resistance at first. You know, lots of excuses and reasons why this would be a problem and it would bother people. But in the end, the city did come forward and we now have it's much safer for blind people to be able to navigate their environment. The other case I'll just mention, which didn't come about as a result of a complaint per se, was actually the Manitoba Commission itself took on this issue. And that is, if any of you have been traveling on the public bus system, you will know that you can hear audible announcements telling you what stops you're at. So they audibly announced the various stops. And the commission went to the city and said, here's an issue for you to deal with. We know that there have been complaints in other jurisdictions on this matter. They've been successful. Why not? Let's get this going without a complaint. Why not think about doing it now? And again, the city of Winnipeg did step up and they did agree to implement the call all stops system. At first the drivers were doing it and then they instituted a more automatic system. And again, interestingly, that there was resistance. People thought it was bothersome to be on the bus and hear these things, and the drivers were not happy with it. But it just shows you that over time, if you just keep pushing, suddenly it just becomes a part of an everyday occurrence. Like I get on the bus, nobody says anything, it's there, makes my life just so much easier to know that I'm getting off at the right spot and that I'm gonna cross the street with an audible pedestrian signal. And it makes my life much easier.
Absolutely.
But that came around for the Human Rights Commission.
You also served as the chairperson of the Manitoba Accessibility Advisory Council. And, you know, and we, as chairperson, we're responsible for developing the recommendations to leading to accessibility standards in issues such as transportation and the design of public spaces and customer service and so forth. And you've been involved in it for a long time. Is accessibility legislation bringing about the changes needed, you know, to change the lives of persons with disabilities?
Well, I'm going to answer in my personal capacity and not representing any particular institution. I would say, first of all, that having accessibility legislation and the accompanying standards are extremely important. It's extremely important because I think it creates a commitment and awareness that there are barriers out there that need to be addressed. And it sets out ways for redressing those barriers. And I think it's having some impact. I guess where I worry personally is we have a lot of different instruments in this country and in this province to do the right thing, but we struggle to get that right thing done. And I find that accessibility in some cases in Manitoba is very good and in some cases very wanting. So it's inconsistent. There are still lots of barriers out there. Well, why is that? I mean, I guess what I say is, you know, it's all well and fine to have the awareness and to say we need to do these things, but you've got to enforce it. You've got to be able to have a system out there that ensures that these things are happening. People have lots of priorities. And if there isn't somebody knocking on their door saying this is a priority, you know, other things get in the way. And you know, right at this moment in Manitoba, we can see how enforcement is needed in terms of getting people to understand and comply with the public health rules around the pandemic. So I think the same thing in terms of accessibility. We need to have that kind of enforcement that ensures that people understand how important it is. But I, you know, as I say, I'm very glad that we have these standards. I just think our next step is take it up a notch and let's make sure it really gets integrated into how we do business. Because, you know, nobody says, oh, you know, I don't think I'm going to institute those fire safety regulations because it's, you know, we got other things to do. We need to say the same thing about accessibility. It's something that just is right there. It's part of the integrated into the design. And there's not a, you know, second guessing or thinking about it. It just gets done.
I want to touch on just something internationally in the Convention of Rights of Persons with Disabilities. Canada signed on and ratified the convention in 2010, but it's also non-binding, meaning it holds no legal status in Canada and there's no penalties assigned for failing to achieve any of the articles of the convention. What is the importance of the Convention of the Rights of Persons with Disability in your
mind? I really think it's very important, actually. And while it isn't on its own, enforceable, as you say, it is a very important interpretive tool. And it can be used both in terms of, assessing equality claims that may go to court, It's also important in terms of the kinds of actions and initiatives that government undertakes. The reason I think it's important is if you look at the convention itself, it sets out very, very specific steps that governments need to take in terms of providing access, in terms of providing employment, in terms of ensuring income security, in terms of providing proper education, technical aids, education. It's very, very, very specific. And so, you know, it I think provides a blueprint, if you will, in terms of what governments need to be doing. So if we combine the convention with existing domestic tools, like the charter, like human rights legislation, like social policy, government programming, if we use that as our foundation, I think it can provide just excellent, excellent guidance. I think, if I can just say, you know, we've spent a lot of time in this country thinking about the convention and what does it mean and how do we, you know, and consulting with people on how to implement it. And I think this is all important, but, you know, it's 10 years later. We shouldn't still be at the drawing board stage. So personally, again, I'm a little frustrated. Like, let's just get on with it. And maybe that's what we're going to see with the, you know, the new Accessible Canada Act that's on the drawing board right now.
Which kind of leads me to, you know, my, you know, last question, which is, you know, in the last couple decades, there's been any number of binding and non-binding international agreements and legislative initiatives to improve the lives of persons with disabilities. But despite these achievements, measured against almost any established social criteria, persons with disabilities are amongst the most disadvantaged. They generally have a high unemployment rates, lower levels of post-secondary education, lower levels of housing, and higher cases of social isolation. What has to be done? Knowing all that has been accomplished and all the things that have been in place to make these improvements, what has to be done to take the next step, to make the person, the persons with disabilities, you know, achieve a higher lot in life?
Yeah, that's the huge million-dollar question. We, I think, have to recognize that we have a lot of tools in our basket. I'm not saying that there can't be more tools, but we've spent a lot of time crafting these tools. Now we need to double down and make them work. And I think that the time, you know, we need to say, how do we enforce all these good things that we have on paper? And it you know, it comes down to political will. Well, how do we, you know, garner political goodwill? I mean, we lobby. And I think, you know, we absolutely need to support and provide resources to our advocacy groups to keep governments honest and hold their feet to the fire. We need that. We need to use the courts. I don't think we're using them as much as we could. And there are, I know it takes resources, but there are resources out there. But we need to use the courts to enforce our rights. And you know, I think we need to just double down and work really hard and, you know, do what other minority groups are doing, you know, in terms of making their views known through various, you know, social action. And maybe we need to get, you know, back to the days, the 60s and 70s and 80s when, you know, we expressed our views on the street. And I don't want to, you know, be suggesting that it's all about protest, but I think we need to get our views known out there. It's got to be political pressure. And, you know, that can happen from the outside and it can also happen from the inside. So I think we also need to be sure that we get people who are at those boardroom tables, who are at the cabinet table. We do have some people with disabilities there now, I think, who are working hard, but we need to be in the inside and we need to be on the outside, making our best efforts to realize many of the rights that we've, set out in our wonderful documents that we've signed on to. But I want to just say, in addition to that, and this is something we haven't maybe done as well on, accessibility and removing barriers is key. It's very important. But we also need to look at the social disadvantage that many people with disabilities experience in terms of income and poverty. And I don't think we've done enough that we, of course, have various jurisdictions and matters of income for people with disabilities are handled quite differently. I think we need a strategy that really lifts people with disabilities up and out of poverty. It's amazing how many barriers you can start to address if you have some resources. So, I say keep on doing what we're doing, but do it more. And I think we really now have to focus our attention on the issue of income insecurity for people with disabilities. I think that's where our priority has to be over the next several years.
Thank you so much, Yvonne. You've been,
it's been
great. I think that we really appreciate your generosity and speaking with us, and sharing your insights.
It's my passion.
And your passion on this passion. Very important day. Thank you, Yvonne.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Yvonne and John, for that wonderful conversation, and Yvonne for your insights and your ongoing commitment to disability rights. As noted by Minister Stephenson, as we celebrate Manitoba 150, we can all take pride in the exceptional leadership of Manitobans with disabilities, as demonstrated by that conversation. Now, I think some of you may have been waiting for the inaugural introduction about Manitoba Accessibility Awards. So about our Manitoba Accessibility Awards, this is the first time that we're celebrating Manitoba organizations and businesses that have shown leadership and innovation in accessibility. This being the first year, I really have to thank the Manitoba Accessibility Awards Committee that also functioned as the selection committee as we worked out the process for the awards and how we would carry them out this year, a year of a pandemic in which we could not meet in person. So many thanks to the organizations that helped us. Manitoba Possible, Reaching Equality for Employment, Community Futures, SEE LifeWorks, March of Dimes, and Manitoba League of People with Disabilities, who were all involved in our awards event. We also want to thank the nominators for their recommendations, and we want to recognize the following nominees that were all shortlisted in this process. So on the next slide, you will see a number of these nominees listed. Included are City of Selkirk, City of Winnipeg, Community Futures Heartland, Equality Communication Center of Excellence, Gateway Church, Herman Pryor, Provincial Exhibition of Manitoba, Pelican Yacht Club, Red Apple Stonewall, RM of Victoria Beach, Southwest Community Options, Unit 204 Productions, Winnipeg Airports Authority, Woodlands Pioneer Museum, and the World Trade Center, Winnipeg. So thank you to everyone. Even though not everyone was able to win the awards, everyone showed fantastic examples of accessibility and inclusion that we hope to highlight in various materials in the year to come. We were so impressed, along with the selection committee, that we actually created an extra two categories. So the categories for this year's Manitoba Accessibility Awards included business, large and small, nonprofit organizations, urban and rural, and large and small municipalities. So without further ado, here are this year's award winners. In the category of large business, I am pleased to announce this year's award winner is the Winnipeg Airports Authority. And we're fortunate that they were able to share a video with us of all the exciting things that they've been doing at the airports. So we'll share the video at this time.
Jen Cameron of the MyYWG Accessibility Committee responds to questions on accessibility.
What does accessibility mean to you, and how is accessibility enhanced by your award-winning initiative? For Winnipeg Airports Authority, accessibility means working together with our partners on an ongoing basis to ensure the services and facilities offered at Winnipeg Richardson International Airport reflect the diverse needs of our community. It's always been WAA's goal for every traveler coming through the airport to be able to anticipate an excellent travel experience. To accomplish this, we are working with a number of partners to reduce barriers and further offer accessibility services to ensure everyone can feel comfortable and supported when they visit the airport.
A man with a white cane uses Aira on his mobile device to check in for a flight at a self-serve kiosk.
In the past year, Winnipeg Richardson International Airport was one of the first airports in Canada to launch Aira, an assistive technology service that helps travelers who are blind or have low vision gain access to their immediate surroundings.
A Will autonomous mobility device moves by itself through the airport.
WAA also explored an exciting partnership with Will. This is to trial an autonomous personal mobility device for future use at the airport.
Screen goes back to Jen Cameron.
Apart from technology, WAA leads an accessibility committee. This is comprised of community and airport partners alike, all working together to steer informed decisions to enhance accessibility at the airport. An example of this work is the launch of the passenger rehearsal program.
An airport employee, a man with a guide dog, along with a woman and a sighted guide walk through the check-in area of the airport.
This program invites individuals with disabilities or who require additional support.
Two women place their luggage on the baggage handling system
to sign up to receive a personalized guided tour of the airport before their next trip.
A woman and a sighted guide have their bags checked by a CATSA screening officer.
This service helps to alleviate anxiety and build traveler confidence prior to catching a flight out of Winnipeg.
Screen goes back to Jen Cameron.
WAA also hosted a special one-day event to expand upon the program by inviting 16 guests with different individual needs to move through a mock travel experience to identify barriers and provide first-hand feedback. All of these initiatives combined are contributing to help build a more inclusive and accessible airport environment at Winnipeg Richardson International Airport. What was the significance of community collaboration? Community collaboration is an integral component of the ongoing work happening at Winnipeg Richardson International Airport under the umbrella of accessibility.
A man talks with an Air Canada agent as his guide dog sits nearby.
By working together with individuals and community organizations, WAA has been able to gain valuable feedback to incorporate different perspectives and more voices into future planning at the airport.
Screen goes back to Jen Cameron.
This insight is greatly valued by our team as we work to ensure airport facilities and services open the door for more people to be able to experience the joys of travel. Community-based partnerships have also assisted in raising awareness of the different accessibility services and programs that we offer at the airport.
A Will autonomous mobility device passes by Skylights Lounge in the departures area of the airport.
Some of these services may be the difference between someone deciding to travel or not based on their level of comfort. And it is extremely valuable to have these partners sharing our information to reach different audiences and resonate with more people.
Screen goes back to Jen Cameron.
We look forward to following up on the conversations we've already started with our community and have plans to work together on new initiatives in the near future. What advice do you have for other organizations that wish to improve their accessibility? It's been extremely beneficial for Winnipeg Airports Authority to leverage the expertise and advice of select community organizations who work with persons with disabilities on a daily basis to implement meaningful change in the area of equal access.
A man and his guide dog are assisted through the check-in area of the airport by an Air Canada agent.
We also have further looked to our community to gain firsthand feedback from individuals with disabilities.
Screen goes back to Jen Cameron.
Or who require additional support at the airport to consider and incorporate many different perspectives.
Kirk Goodlett, chair of the MyYWG Accessibility Committee, speaks to a group of seated individuals taking part in the passenger rehearsal program.
It is important to communicate the work you are doing as a company to generate momentum.
Screen goes back to Jen Cameron.
With each new program, service, or feature we introduce at the airport, more team members are continuing to deepen their understanding of accessibility and view processes and practices from an inclusive lens. This continues to lead to increased engagement, new ideas, and company-wide collaboration to shape a more inclusive airport to serve our community. What does winning this award mean to you? Winnipeg Airports Authority is extremely honored to receive this prestigious recognition on behalf of the Manitoba Accessibility Award Selection Committee. This award is affirmation our continued efforts to provide an accessible airport environment is creating a positive impact within our community. And it also further supports our vision to be leaders in transportation, innovation, and growth.
An airport employee assists a passenger who is deaf.
As an airport, we're required to meet specific accessibility regulations, but our team is always finding ways to go above and beyond and exceed those expectations to benefit everyone who visits the airport.
A woman uses a Will autonomous mobility device to navigate the departures area of the airport as another woman walks beside her.
It is great to see those actions and efforts acknowledged, and at the same time, it really proves the point that when we work together, we can make a greater impact.
Screen goes back to Jen Cameron.
This award recognizes programs and initiatives that wouldn't have been possible without the support of a number of organizations, partners, and team members all working together.
A man has his boarding pass scanned at the gate by an Air Canada agent.
As an example, the passenger rehearsal program involved lobbying Transport Canada to allow for a security exemption. And now, other airports across Canada are able to introduce a similar program for persons with disabilities.
A woman and a sighted guide walk past Gate 9 in the departures area of the airport. Bright natural light fills the terminal from the floor to ceiling windows behind them.
Thank you for selecting Winnipeg Airports Authority for this award, and it is a token that will further inspire our team to continue to make travel accessible and enjoyable for all at Winnipeg Richardson International Airport.
And thank you for that excellent video. You can bet we'll want to be using that video for other training in the next year, including the great example of descriptive video where all different images are shared with people who are blind. That brings us next to the category of small business. You will note that there were several questions addressed by Jen Cameron. We asked the same questions of our various winners only about 3-4 weeks ago. And in that time, some were able to create videos. And in some cases, we helped create a video with the images they supplied. And that's the case in the category of small business. This year's winner is Red Apple, Stonewall, Manitoba. And here is our short video to talk about the features of that store.
Red Apple, Stonewall. The title page features four red balls representing four questions connected by black lines displayed across the screen. Ball 1, Question 1. What does accessibility mean to you, and how is accessibility enhanced by your award-winning initiative? To us, accessibility means being accepting and accommodating everyone who comes into our store. Our goal every day is to gift our customers by providing excellent customer service. We greet them with a smile, inform them of our in-store specials and upcoming promotions, exude friendliness when speaking and helping customers, and we thank them for shopping with us. We believe that our gift method enhances our definition of accessibility because we want customers to feel comfortable and respected during their shopping experience, by our associates going above and beyond their expectations throughout their visit. A photo of one of the store's accessibility features, wide aisles have been implemented in the clothing department to increase accessibility. Racks of clothing are pictured on either side of the aisle. A photo of one of the store's accessibility features, the height of shelving units, is adjusted to allow customers to easily reach for products. Various household appliances are pictured on a low shelf. Ball 2, question 2. What was the significance of community collaboration? Community collaboration is very important to us. One of our company's core values is to connect with our community, in which we take great pride in serving and being a part of the town of Stonewall in everything that we do. Every year, we support our local food bank and local Christmas cheer board by holding our annual food drive and toy drive. We donate silent auction prizes to community events, and for the past 2 years, we have volunteered and donated outfits to Community Living Interlake's Fall Fashion Show, which raises money to purchase equipment and support people with disabilities living in the community. Community collaboration is important because it shows our customers that we are committed to getting involved and that we are understanding and support those in need in our community. Photo of a box filled with food and the message, help support our food drive. Photo of a house with the message, something beautiful, which is one of Community Living's Interlake's initiatives. Photo of text that reads Community Living Interlake. Ball 3, question 3. What advice do you have for other organizations that wish to improve their accessibility? Our advice would be to do their research, talk to organizations in their area about meeting accessibility needs, create a survey to get feedback, find resources and tools to train those in your organization about the Accessibility Act, get involved in the community and talk to people about what your organization can do to best improve accessibility. A photo of a hand placing paper in a feedback box. Photo of the Accessibility for Manitobans Act text. Ball 4, question 4. What does winning this award mean to you? Winning this award means that we are taking the right steps in accommodating and providing a welcoming atmosphere for people with disabilities. It also means that we are standing by our customer service policy statement, which states that our company is committed to excellence in giving people with disabilities the same opportunities and benefits to our goods and services. Photo of a person wearing a personal protective mask located behind a table of food items with a sign that reads Food Drive. Photo of text that reads Together We Care with a heart and stickman.
Thank you, Red Apple, for providing those thorough responses to our questions. And I love the store statement that is committed to providing equal access to goods and services to Manitobans with disabilities. It's wonderful. That moves us to the next category, which is nonprofit organizations. Beginning with urban nonprofit organization, the Manitoba Accessibility Award winner in 2020 is, congratulations, Gateway Church. And thank you for providing us the following video.
Good afternoon. My name is Betty Alexander, and I'm with Gateway Church in Winnipeg. It's my pleasure to speak with you today, and on behalf of Gateway, I wish to express our gratitude to the Awards Committee for including us in this esteemed list of recipients for this Accessibility Award. Thank you very much. I'd like to share a couple of thoughts with you today about accessibility. To me, accessibility is an evolving term. You know, when I was a little girl, we didn't have things like curb cuts or ramps or automatic door openers. But as the term began to pop up in our cultural conversation, it was synonymous with physical access. But from there, it has now come to mean the identification and removal of barriers for all kinds of disabilities, so that everyone can engage in community life. As for us at Gateway, I'm most enthused and proud of the 150 people who have completed the accessible customer service training, 85% of which are unpaid volunteers. Our vision statement is this: Gateway Church exists to spread a passion for the glory of God through Jesus Christ to every nation and every generation. So I'm not surprised that the people of Gateway are interested and engaged in creating a more inclusive and accessible church environment. Collaboration is essential if you want to improve your accessibility, and for us, it meant reaching out to the people in our congregation who are living with the effects of a disability. They are the experts in the field, and they were able to provide us with insights and information that helped guide the changes and improvements that we've been able to make. The Disabilities Office is a great resource community. The staff there are passionate, informed, and really want to help. Also for us, we reached out to Ontario. They have created a guide for accessibility in places of worship. They kindly sent us several copies, which was full of great information for our sector, which we found really helpful. For advice, I think the best piece of advice I could give would be to appoint an accessibility coordinator who will research and keep management, staff, and volunteers informed on updates in legislation and on what's happening with accessibility in the province. The coordinator will manage and track all training and will participate in the creation of any needed policies. I'd also recommend writing an annual accessibility report. This will keep accessibility vibrant and at the forefront of your organization. And that's important because we really are at the beginning of this journey. Gateway is a church, a place of worship. And if ever there's a place where someone, regardless of ability, should be able to come and feel welcome, accepted, and valued, and be able to fully engage, it's at their place of worship. So winning this award means to us, assures us that we are working in the right direction and that we are, in fact, moving forward, which is really encouraging to us. We also hope to be an inspiration to other places of worship to begin or to continue on their own journey to improve accessibility. Accessibility isn't just important because it's the right thing to do. It's important because it promotes inclusion. And inclusion is the only way to create and sustain true community. And an inclusive society is indeed a noble goal. Thank you all for your kind attention, and thanks again to the awards committee. We really do feel honored. I wish you all the very best as we continue this journey to a fully accessible Manitoba. Thank you.
And thank you to Gateway Church for that excellent video. And as someone who works in public awareness on accessibility, it is so heartening how the various messages presented today complement one another, and how important it is to all the winners to have spoken to experts with disabilities in their congregation, among their customers, among people flying in Manitoba. I think that is one thing that all applicants had in common, is that they talked to people who face barriers to find out what should be the priorities in removing those barriers. So thank you very much, and congratulations to Gateway. The next category of winner, which is in the rural area, not-for-profit organization, Rural 2020 Manitoba Accessibility Award winner this year is Woodlands Pioneer Museum.
Woodlands Pioneer Museum. The title page contains four questions located in boxes with a photo of a path and accessibility ramp on the Woodlands Pioneer Museum property. Box 1, Question 1. What does accessibility mean to you, and how is accessibility enhanced by your award-winning initiative? Accessibility, as identified in the Statement of Commitment to our plan, means working to ensure that all people, regardless of abilities, have equal access, participation, and inclusion at the Woodlands Pioneer Museum. It means treating all people in ways which foster the maintenance of their dignity, safety, and independence. Winning this award underlines the seriousness of our intent, not only in achieving our goals related to accessibility, but sharing the message that it is both necessary and possible. Examples of how we have enhanced accessibility include such interventions as planning, policy development, diligent training of staff and volunteers, the construction of accessible parking, walkways, ramps, and handrails, virtual tours of areas where mobility may limit access and meeting all the expectations of the Manitoba Accessibility for Customer Service. We also have met the objectives identified thus far in the employment standard. Photo of an accessible parking spot sign outside the Woodlands Pioneer Museum with buildings in the background. Box 2, Question 2. What was the significance of community collaboration? We had the support of the Rural Municipality of Woodlands staff in their policies. Grant requests for goals related to accessibility were prioritized. We were successful in obtaining grant funds, locally as well as federally, for several of our projects. We have a broad base of volunteers from a small community, and our board of directors is large, as members stay for subsequent terms due to a strong belief in our mission. It is this group that has collaborated on our accessibility plan, volunteered to assist with the completion of projects, and now celebrates our success in achieving our goals and recognition through this award. Photo of a newspaper clipping with the title Virtual Access to Museum that features two smiling staff members of the Woodlands Pioneer Museum. Box 3, Question 3. What advice do you have for other organizations that wish to improve their accessibility? Make accessibility a household word in organizational discussions and planning. The Woodlands Pioneer Museum is a small, not-for-profit organization completely managed by volunteers, the majority of whom are seniors. Do not view making your organization accessible as an insurmountable task, but start by candidly identifying barriers. You will have taken the most important step. Removing one barrier at a time is absolutely achievable. Many funding bodies prioritize projects enhancing accessibility. Search them out. Get your community on board and seek involvement and feedback from community members who will most benefit from your accessibility features. The Disabilities Issues Office has very valuable resources and was very helpful. Photo of a binder that reads Woodlands Pioneer Museum Accessibility Plan, featuring various subsections pertaining to accessibility. Box 4, Question 4. What does winning this award mean to you? The highlight of this award was receiving the nomination support letter from a community senior who identified benefits to her from our work. She spoke of the significance of being treated with respect. If the nomination process ended at this point, we would have already won. The recognition of winning the award is very much appreciated, but the achievement of our goals is a reward as well. Winning the award adds to the credibility of our statement of commitment to our accessibility plan. Photo of a large newspaper article with the title, Woodlands Museum Introduces Accessible Pathways, that feature two smiling staff members in front of the Woodlands Pioneer Museum.
Thank Thank you to Woodlands for that excellent example. And I should do a little marketing for Woodlands, because this Pioneer Museum is all of 15 minutes outside of Winnipeg on Highway 6. And I went with my mother, and one thing not mentioned there that we were pleased about was the accessible King's Washroom. That attention to detail, to accessible paths, even for a small rural museum, I think is an excellent signal of the commitment of Manitobans to accessibility. Our next award category, the final award category, is municipalities, beginning with large municipalities. And the 2020 Manitoba Accessibility Award winner is the City of Selkirk, which has provided us with a beautiful video of all the accessibility features. So enjoy.
Thank you to the Manitoba Accessibility Awards Selection Committee for choosing the City of Selkirk as the 2020 Accessible Awards winner in the large and small municipality category. I also want to thank Edie Hendrickson, our Director of Corporate Services, who has led the development of our accessibility plan and continues to be an accessibility champion. The City of Selkirk's Community Strategic Plan is in large part a roadmap to building a more inclusive community. The operative part of our mission statement is to enhance the opportunity and quality of life for all citizens. 1 in 4 Manitobans face accessibility challenges. That means 25% of our citizens face barriers to making full use and benefit of the services and amenities we offer. It also means that as a community, we risk missing out on getting the full benefit of the ideas and skills and passion and engagement of a quarter of our people.
It's very important to make buildings accessible so that all people with all needs can use those facilities to the best of their abilities. By adding accessible doors, every public-facing door can be accessible to everybody that uses it. Making those little differences can make a big impact to those people that need those kind of resources when they're using those facilities.
We don't see improving accessibility as just a moral imperative. We also see it as a strategic opportunity. Using our award-winning and innovative asset management program, we are renewing infrastructure. As we do that, we are making sure that accessibility and equity are top of mind.
When we do a sewer project or a water project, we're also looking at the sidewalk infrastructure so that when we can repair in such a way that makes it more accessible to our citizens to a proper grade when we're doing those kind of projects.
We are also keeping accessibility in mind as we develop our services and our online infrastructure. Our citizen support program is a one-stop shop for accessing city services. Our citizen support representatives offer a human touch and will work with citizens to navigate our systems and access the services that they need. We've adopted the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines 2.1 for our website and continue to develop and offer more self-serve options online that add flexibility and convenience to better meet the needs of our citizens. It means educating and raising the awareness of our staff by incorporating accessibility training into the orientation program that every new employee of the city goes through. It means changing and creating policies that consider equity as an intended outcome of the work that we do and prioritizing projects that enhance accessibility. It means establishing feedback loops like our Age Friendly Committee to ensure council and administration are hearing about the needs directly from those who are impacted.
We felt it was important to get a different perspective and kind of be more inclusive of the groups that could be served better. One of the groups that we consulted with, the Selkirk Recreation Strategy, was Selkirk Age Friendly. We had numerous facility or program implementations for the future, and one of the current projects we have is our Selkirk Trails Concept Plan. And so we've enlisted the help of an expert in trail concept planning and design. If we can make our trails accessible, and how does that look for us going forward? And how can we make that happen?
There's a lot more to do, but we are moving forward on our accessibility journey with intention and holding the firm belief that a more accessible Selkirk is a stronger Selkirk.
Thank you to the City of Selkirk for that excellent example. Our final category, Small Municipality 2020 Accessibility Award winner, which this year is the RM of Victoria Beach. Congratulations. And using images off season, so snow covered, we have a brief video about Victoria Beach accessibility features.
RM of Victoria Beach. The title page features a scene of a sailboat moving through the water with a trail of 4 lily pads and several aquatic flowers behind it. Each lily pad represents a different question. Please note that all photos featured in this presentation were taken after a recent snowfall. The buildings pictured are closed for the winter season. Lily Pad 1. Question 1. What does accessibility mean to you, and how is accessibility enhanced by your award-winning initiative? Accessibility means improving the ability of all persons with disabilities to achieve their best and to participate in and enjoy their surroundings in a safe and respectful manner. An accessible community takes all reasonable steps to ensure that persons with disabilities can participate in and take advantage of the infrastructure, assets, and supports that are available to residents and visitors. Investing in and contributing to accessibility in our community brings tremendous benefits and rewards to our residents and visitors with disabilities, and also enriches the entire fabric of the municipality. Our municipality supports the ongoing improvements to accessibility in our community, and winning this award will provide us with a positive message to further inform and educate our community about accessibility. Photo of a ramp walkway and large green recycle bins on the right. The recycling area at VB has a platform that can be accessed by a ramp and/or stairs to allow people to drop off their co-mingled recycling into a large bin. VB is making further modifications to the recycling area to ensure all residents have easy access to the bins. Photo of a small yellow building with a window and doors with a sign above the door that reads Information Office. There is a window on either side of the information office for obtaining information on foot or in a vehicle. The doorbell is situated so that it can be reached from a mobility device and will alert an attendant to come out to assist an individual. Lily Pad 2. Question 2. What was the significance of community collaboration? The RM of Victoria Beach is very fortunate to have an engaged, experienced, and thoughtful group of community members who form our Community Accessibility Committee. The majority of this group have been together for the better part of 5 years and have worked with the Municipal Council to ensure accessibility standards are met or exceeded within the municipality. Our Community Accessibility Group has a wealth of knowledge and experiences to draw from, and their input is invaluable in the planning and provision of meeting the goals of the provincial accessibility standards. Photo of an outdoor accessibility door button. An automatic door was installed at the Victoria Beach General Store during the summer of 2020. Photo of a series of protected electrical outlets for electrical wheelchairs and other mobility devices located under a wooden railing. The covered charging area for mobility devices is attached to the summer taxi building. There is room for approximately 10 mobility devices to be under cover and charging. The RMVB offers 4 mobility scooters for short-term rental during the summer months. Lily Pad 3. Question 3. What advice do you have for other organizations that wish to improve their accessibility? Engage with your community members, form a community accessibility committee or advisory group to ensure, as much as possible, that the needs of all persons with disabilities are considered in the planning processes. We are only one step or one moment away from living with a disability, and we all need to consider the impacts of not only our infrastructure, but our comments, actions, and inaction that could impact the well-being and support of persons with disabilities. Photo of the side of Einfeld's Bakery, also known as the VB Bakery. The photo features a wooden bungalow-style building with an accessibility ramp and stairs. The stairs are painted with yellow strips. An automatic door, larger entrance platform, and door transition strip are planned for 2021. Photo of the entrance to a wooden building with a sign above a door that reads Einfeld's Bakery. To the side, an accessibility ramp is featured. The bakery was modified during summer 2020 to allow easier maneuverability of mobility devices on the corner section. VB is planning to add an automatic door, better transition strip, and larger landing outside the front door. Lilypad 4, Question 4. What does winning this award mean to you? The RM of Victoria Beach Council is humbled to have been nominated by our Accessibility Committee, and we are honored to be recognized as a leader in improvements to accessibility that are being made in our community. As the mayor of the municipality, and as someone who has been involved in our Community Accessibility Committee since its inception, I am very proud of our accomplishments to date, and proud of the support and direction of our committee. Our committee chair, Rod Bowman, continues to guide our committee forward, and he deserves our thanks for that leadership and direction. The RM of Victoria Beach recognizes that we have some accomplishments to be proud of, but we also recognize that we need to continue to promote and plan for ongoing accessibility improvements in our municipality. Photo of stairs located outside a building. The stairs of the VB General Store feature painted yellow strips and an easy grip handrail. Photo of an accessibility ramp located outside a building. The ramp was widened and smaller railings were attached on both sides.
So congratulations to all our winners. And on that last video, thank you also to Thomas Sturr, who provided our voiceover. The winners will all be receiving a trophy, as well as the use of our 2020 Manitoba Accessibility Award winner logo, which you see on the left of the screen. And stay tuned for this weekend's Winnipeg Free Press, in which we will be celebrating the award winners for 2020. So that concludes our award celebration. And I just want to add, a number of people mentioned resources at the Disabilities Issues Office, nowadays Manitoba Accessibility Office, and a few of them are on your screen right now. So we recently held webinars for Disability Employment Awareness Month, Manitoba Access Awareness Week, and those can be found online. And in the near future, you will also find today's award ceremony online at accessibilitymb.ca. And I want to point out that we have a new webpage focused on COVID-19. So the featured content includes the impact of COVID-19 on Manitobans with disabilities. There is a long list of resources. And as you will see on the right, there is a social media toolkit so that all our champions of accessibility can help spread the word that during COVID-19, as we all take precautions to stay safe, that we still maintain accessibility. And with an example here of offering flexible customer service to customers and clients with disabilities. There are a number of tips like this one for businesses and for not-for-profit organizations. So please see that resource and look for tips for accessible service during COVID-19 and how to keep employees safe. That concludes our event today. So special thanks go to Erica Vass, who is sitting behind me today, and Rocco, who's Scarcello, who is providing support from home. It is their tech knowledge that has brought us the event today. I know I wouldn't have been able to do it. There are others in our small office of six people who are also all involved today. Colleen Waters helped coordinate the awards committee. Thank you for that support. As well, John Windles, you saw on screen, and Tracy McMillan, whose normal day job is as office manager. You heard her voicing over two of the awards. So this is an incredible office I belong to, that small 6-person office, and I'm so proud to be celebrating International Day of Persons with Disabilities with this group. So in closing, I also want to thank Yvonne Peters, as well as all of the other video participants, award winners that we featured today. They were all a big part of bringing you explanations about how accessibility can be achieved. So to close, I just want to send a message of resilience and patience. Manitobans with disabilities know all about that. The rest of us are trying to learn quickly. As we close 2020, and we wish you all the best of the holiday season, know that we have a better 2021 coming to us with a vaccine we can all anticipate and an opportunity to come together once more. We look forward to seeing you in 2021. Thank you for staying tuned today.